to try and please me. You never let me down before.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Ask the Blood Detective, a weekly podcast meant to take you beyond the basics of health so you can become your own blood and health detective. My name is Dr. Wald, and my branding is Blood Detective, and throughout these shows, you'll see why. For those of you who want my information to send me your show topics or to provide any feedback, whether they're criticisms or comments, on any of these topics, you can reach me at 914-552-1442. I'm located in Westchester's Chappaqua, New York, which is about an hour north of New York City. My email to send your questions to is info@blooddetective.com, and my website is drmichaelwald.com. So that's drmichaelwald.com. Today's topic is joyful juicing or not, which means that juicing is not necessarily for everyone. There are certainly benefits of juicing in certain people for specific conditions when done correctly. And of course, there are negatives. And I find throughout my practice, and I have been practicing now for over 30 years, that there's a lot of confusion in the area of juicing. So I hope to clear up a bunch of that today. So what we'll discuss in today's show, Joyful Juicing or Not, is conditions that might benefit or may be worsened by juicing. I'm going to spend some time on types of juicers, both of their advantages and their disadvantages, how to choose the right combinations of fruits and vegetables that you are juicing, and I'll speak about the purpose of juicing, why should we juice, when should we not juice, and how do we use various laboratory tests like blood work to help determine what nutrition you need that would help you focus on the types of fruits and vegetables that you need, and some more details. So I'm going to start with some practical information that I think you're going to find very interesting. I'm going to talk about some health conditions and how they might be helped or hurt with juicing. Now, most of you have heard of low thyroid, which is commonly referred to as hypothyroid. Hypo is low, hyper is high. But low thyroid, hypo, if you have low thyroid function, you're actually going to want to avoid juicing with certain foods. For example, cruciferous vegetables like broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, they can interfere with thyroid function. It's been known for decades that they can interfere with thyroid function. Now, some of you are thinking, but aren't those healthy? Well, no, they're not healthy for those with hypothyroid if the person is wanting to adjust their diet to give their thyroid a chance to come back. So instead of these cruciferous vegetables, the broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, for example, you can opt for leafy greens like kale, spinach, collard greens, which are rich in iodine, which support thyroid health. So you probably know that there are thyroid blood tests. In thyroid blood tests, a few of them consist of what is known as T3 and T4. And the 3 stands for three iodines attached to the T, which is an amino acid known as tyrosine. So T3, three iodines, T4, four iodines. And the body takes T4, removes an iodine, and makes T3. That's the active, or what we call the free T3. Let's move on to another very common issue that may be benefited or hurt with juicing, and that is low blood sugar, which is hypoglycemia. Now, you might have low blood sugar, meaning your blood sugar might be out of the normal blood range, or you might suffer from low blood sugar because you're too low in the normal range. For individuals with low blood sugar, it's important, if not essential, to choose fruits and vegetables that are high in natural sugars and complex carbohydrates. So some good options include bananas, which are a little bit on the green side because the sugars are less broken down when they're on the green side. So they're released more slowly in the body, and that won't promote hypoglycemia. And other good options for low blood sugar are usually apples and sweet potatoes. It's also a good idea to add some protein-rich ingredients to your fruit, smoothies, let's say, or to your diet to help manage blood sugar, including raw nuts and seeds. When you roast nuts and seeds, everyone, you actually saturate the fats in them, and that is what increases cholesterol. Saturated fats in the diet increase cholesterol in the body more than cholesterol in the diet. But back to low blood sugar. In addition to this protein-rich approach with the complex carbohydrates, I gave a few examples, apples and bananas, sweet potatoes, also Greek yogurt, adding that to your juices also can help stabilize blood sugar levels. And what about high blood sugar or hyperglycemia, which is by definition blood sugar which is out of the normal blood glucose range on a blood test? But you, again, might still have hyperglycemic symptoms, high blood sugar symptoms, if you're in the normal range of blood sugar, but on the high end. This whole high end and low end concept that I'm introducing to you, this is called the blood detective approach to labs, because there are better and worse places to be in a range. We'll talk about this more later, and I'm referring to ranges on blood tests. So let's talk about what fruits we should avoid to make sure we don't cause hyperglycemia. So it's best to avoid fruits and vegetables that are high in what are called natural sugars. So instead, you want to opt for those fruits and vegetables that are lower in sugar and higher in fiber, both soluble fiber and non-soluble fiber. And some examples would include leafy greens for juicing, along with cucumbers and celery. Berries like blueberries, raspberries, strawberries, they're also very good choices as they're low in sugar and very high in antioxidants and fiber and other phytonutrients that help balance out the blood sugar. So again, we're talking about what fruits and vegetables can help or hurt medical conditions. So what's the next most common category beyond low thyroid, low blood sugar, and high blood sugar? That would be inflammatory conditions. So for individuals with various inflammatory conditions like arthritis or autoimmune diseases, it's important to choose anti-inflammatory ingredients such as turmeric, ginger, and another good one is green tea. So these ingredients help reduce inflammation in the body and help relieve symptoms. So leafy greens like kale and spinach are also really good, very good choices as they're rich in antioxidants and fibers, and they can help reduce inflammation. However, an anti-inflammatory food for one person might actually be promoting inflammation in another person. So it's important to consult with a healthcare professional that understands how to test for these foods. The next category you want to think about when we're dealing with juicing is allergies. So if you have food allergies to a particular fruit or vegetable, obviously, even if that fruit or vegetable is considered to be healthy, it is not healthy for you. And also, other foods and things that people do tend to juice with, like nuts, seeds, dairy, and soy, may also have allergic problems or may not, depending on your particular system. So you want to think about, if you do have allergies, you want to opt for hypoallergic or low allergic producing ingredients. And those are commonly berries, citrus fruits, and melons. But the only way to really know if you have allergies to a food is sometimes food allergy testing, although food allergy testing is not particularly accurate, especially in people with inflammation. I'm going to say that again. Inflammation can cause false allergies on testing, just like anti-inflammatory drugs, like non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, Advil, Tylenol, acetaminophen, and prednisone will cause falsely negative food allergy tests. More on that in other shows. And what about enzymes? Your body makes enzymes. Your stomach makes enzymes and acids, as does your pancreas. And the pancreas, being a digestive and a hormonal organ, secretes enzymes into the small intestine in response to foods. But there are many individuals that either don't make enough enzymes or they have just outright enzyme deficiencies to the point where they're not even measurable. So it's important to choose ingredients that are easy to digest and contain natural enzymes. And natural enzymes you'll find in foods like pineapple, papaya, and banana, they're all very high in digestive enzymes, but they're not high enough in many medical conditions to have benefit. So just because a food has enzymes doesn't mean that that level of enzyme is even therapeutic. That's why enzyme supplements are very important to help digestion. If you want to help your digestion with enzymes, let's say exogenous enzymes from a capsule, for example, or a tablet, then you want to take those enzymes with your food, and therefore the enzymes will help you digest your foods. If you want to reduce inflammation, let's say throughout the body, or possibly help digest cancer cells in your circulation or antibodies from autoimmune disease, you want to take enzymes at least a half an hour away from foods so they're not wasted on digesting the food, but they get into the blood instead and they help inflammation and help tissue repair. And I mentioned earlier on about low blood sugar and high blood sugar. That's what we call a glycemic response. When you eat a particular food, your blood sugar is going to go up and down. Usually it'll go up, but how high it goes up or how low it goes down, that's known as the glycemic response. So the glycemic response of a fruit or of a vegetable refers to how quickly it raises blood sugar levels or lowers them. For individuals who need to manage their blood sugar, it's very important to choose ingredients with a low glycemic index. So there is a chart you can look up online called the low glycemic index or the glycemic index, and it'll tell you what are foods with the lowest or the least amount of stress on your blood sugar balancing, and those that are sort of moderately affecting you and others that might be severely affecting your blood sugar balance. But keep in mind, the glycemic index is not based on your chemistry. Everything comes down to individual needs. So this glycemic index might be accurate for you and it might not. I have found it to be accurate maybe 20 to 30% of the time. That's not very high. So good options of foods that can help to regulate and keep your blood sugar or glycemic response more balanced would be leafy greens. Cucumbers are fantastic for that, along with celery. They're all very low in sugar and very high in fiber. And what about something called food intolerances? So if you have food intolerance, it's important to be mindful of the ingredients you choose, obviously, to put in your juicing. So common intolerances include, and yours may be different than this, but common ones that I've seen in my practice is lactose intolerance, gluten intolerance, fructose malabsorption. And instead of milk and wheat, opt for non-dairy alternatives like almond milk and gluten-free oats. Okay, those would help reduce gluten intolerance, or I should say food intolerances. And what about heart disease? I thought this was important to mention since heart disease is the number one killer of both men and women. So for individuals with heart disease, it's important to choose ingredients that are low in sodium and saturated fat. Good options for juicing would be, again, the leafy greens, berries, citrus fruits, which are all low in calories and high in nutrients. Also, omega-3 ingredients like flax seeds and chia seeds, fantastic choices because they help reduce inflammation in a good number of people and improve heart health in some people as well. So in summary, when you're choosing fruits and vegetables for juicing based on health conditions, it's important to consider factors like the sugar content, their inflammation reducing or promoting properties, how well the food may be digestively managed with you, and its glycemic response. So by making this informed choice, now that you know this information, you can create delicious and nutritious juices that support your overall health and well-being. Okay, so that's well and good, right? But what kind of juicer should you use? I should mention at this point that on my website at www.drmichaelwald.com, that's drmichaelwald.com, you'll find under the blog section all of the notes for all of my podcasts. So I do encourage you to take notes, though, because your brain simply learns better as you're taking notes. And when you're taking notes, you are present. And again, you can have a backup when you go to my website. We need to talk about different kinds of juicers. So I'm going to review about six or so different types of juicing machines and their purported advantages and their disadvantages. And please keep in mind, the show is about 50 to 60 minutes, so I can't go through every juicer on the market, so I'm going to go over the different types of juicers. So the first one is a centrifugal juicer. And there are certain advantages to a centrifugal juicer. For example, it is has a very fast juicing speed. It's easy to use and easy to clean, and it can handle a variety of fruits and vegetables. Now, the disadvantages, or some of the disadvantages of centrifugal juicers, are it's kind of noisy, okay? But not the worst thing in the world. It may produce foam or froth in the juice, and it's more expensive than most other juicers. Now, let's talk about another type of juicer called a masticating juicer. Its advantages are it's slow and gentle in terms of the juicing process. You get a much higher juice yield compared to the centrifugal juicers. You'll definitely have less foam and froth in the juice, and it's very easy to clean and maintain. That's the masticating juicer. I hope you're writing this down, everyone. Now, the disadvantages of a masticating juicer are it has a slower juicing speed, it is more expensive, and it may not handle tougher fruits and vegetables as well as some other juicers. And then there is a third type of juicer called a twin gear juicer. So there are certain advantages of a twin gear juicer. It has production of high quality juice. There's very little froth and foam. It can handle practically every kind of fruit and vegetable, and it's very easy to use and clean. The disadvantages of a twin gear juicer are thought to be it's more expensive than most other juicers, it's heavier and it's larger in size, and it may require more effort to assemble it and to disassemble it. And then there is the fourth sort of juicer, which is the hydraulic press juicer. I like this particular juicer. Its advantages include it produces a high yield of juice with minimum foam and froth. It's very easy to clean, and it can handle a variety of fruits and vegetables. Disadvantages of a hydraulic press juicer are it's more expensive than most types of juicers. It may be slower than other types of juicers, and it may require more effort to assemble and disassemble it. And then we have the cold press juicer. So the cold press juicer has certain advantages as well. High quality juice with minimum foam and froth. It's easy to clean. It can handle a variety of fruits and vegetables. There are a few disadvantages, however, of the cold press juicer. It's more expensive than many juicers. It may be slower, and it may require more effort to put it together and take it apart. And then the sixth type of juicer that I can think of is the slow juicer. Now, the advantages of a slow juicer is that it has a high yield and very minimal foam and froth. It's easy to clean and can handle practically every fruit and vegetable. It's got a few disadvantages, the slow juicer. One, it has a slow juicing speed. It may be more expensive than other juicers, and again, it needs to be taken apart and assembled. So, in conclusion, each type of these juice machines has its own advantages, it has its own disadvantages. And the best choice of juicer for you will depend on your specific needs and preferences. And that's something you will talk about with your healthcare provider. So it's not just which juicer is the best, but which juicer is best for you, what you can do, and what your health needs are. For those of you just joining us, my name is Dr. Michael Wald. You're listening to Ask the Blood Detective, a podcast that you can hear every Monday night, or you can look at it at my website, anytime after 6 p.m. on a Monday, or you can search for Ask the Blood Detective on practically any podcast platform, and it'll be there. To reach me, you can call 914-552-1442. Send me your comments about the show, criticisms, that's fine too, show topics. Email those to me at info@blooddetective.com, and check out the website for free content, which is drmichaelwald.com. Okay, a few more important points about types of juices. So there's many concerns about the potential negative effects of juicing on the nutritional content of fruits and vegetables. And, you know, the scientific consensus on this is that juicing is safe And it's an effective way in many people to consume foods. In fact, there's lots of studies that have shown that juicing can increase the bioavailability of nutrients, making them more available to you, such as vitamin C, beta carotene, many other minerals, phytonutrients in various fruits and vegetables. But it is important to note that the quality of the juice you're using and the method of juicing can potentially affect the nutritional content of the final juicing product. So for example, some juicers heat up, and when they do heat up, they produce heat that might destroy some of the nutrients and might inactivate some of the enzymes. Additionally, if you use a low quality or old produce, that'll certainly affect the content of the juice that you're drinking. So you want fresh fruits and vegetables and the right juice for your needs. So let me talk about what I think are the top 10 reasons why juicing is good for you. And then after that, I'm going to give you about the same number, maybe 10 other reasons why juicing may not be good for you. Number one, juicing has the potential of increasing your immune system. And that is something that could be measured by checking your movement of white blood cells under a microscope, which is called a peripheral blood smear or dark field microscope, or looking at your white blood cell count on a blood test. And there are other ways of evaluating your immune system. But juicing that is rich in vitamins and minerals and antioxidants and other phytonutrients can help boost your immune system, helping you fight off various harmful diseases. And also, if you have hyperimmunity, too high of an immune system, which is autoimmune disease, juicing might bring your immune system down. So it can move your immune system up or down depending on your particular health needs. Juicing can aid in digestion. So juicing can help to improve digestion by providing your body with essential enzymes, nutrients that are very important for your gut bacteria to act upon. The other thing that juicing might benefit, this is the third benefit after boosting immune system or regulating the immune system, helping you digest, is increasing energy. So juicing can provide a quick and easy source of energy due to its high concentration of vitamins and minerals. One thing I've noticed among many things in terms of juicing when it's done right over the years of my practice is that juicing can promote very healthy skin. So juicing is rich in antioxidants and vitamins, which are needed for skin to repair and reduce the appearance of wrinkles and fine lines, the color of the skin. Juicing usually results in a glowing skin. Juicing also I've used to support weight loss when it's done correctly. Juicing can help support weight loss by providing a low-calorie, nutrient-dense drink that can help reduce cravings and it increases satiety. In other words, your sensation of feeling full. If you do the right types of juices for your particular, let's say, toxic needs, maybe you have heavy metal toxins, mercury, cadmium, aluminum, for example, or maybe you have toxic inflammatory mediators, or maybe you have toxic hormones. Folks, those various toxins, they need specific types of nutrients to actually detoxify them. It really concerns me when I hear people talking about detoxification in some general way, when they're mostly wasting their time if they're not consuming juices or supplements or eating foods that are not specific for the type of toxin. But when you get that right, juicing can help with detoxification. So juicing can help remove toxins from the body by providing a natural source of not just fiber, but other nutrients that are key for the digestive system, the lymphatic system, and of course, the liver. Also the kidneys. There's many other detoxifying organs. Even the lungs are detoxifying organs. And yes, the skin is as well. Juicing can also improve cognitive function if you're consuming the right juices with the right nutrients that you particularly need for your cognitive decline, which is your thinking, obviously. So juicing is typically rich in antioxidants and other nutrients that can help improve cognitive function and even reduce the risk of age-related diseases such as Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. The eighth benefit that I can think of would be supporting bone health. We know that juicing is a great source of calcium and other minerals. You can't build bones with just calcium. In fact, you can't build bones with just minerals. And even if you have the right minerals and, let's say, proteins, which you need to form something called hydroxyproline for bone health, if you have inflammation in your body, that's going to cause calcium to leach out of your bones. And where does that calcium go? Well, some of it's eliminated through the urine, and some of it attaches to the inside of your blood vessels, causing hardening of the arteries or atherosclerosis. Some of the calcium can also go in your kidneys, giving you kidney stones, and or calcium can microscopically store in your muscles and in your body, causing everything from fibromyalgia to fatigue to muscle aches and pains. So we want calcium to stay in bones, and the right juicing based on your chemistry, a detailed dietary log, and a very detailed medical history and nutritional and physical exam are all essential for figuring out what nutrition you need and what type of juices you should have. And those are all the types of things that I do, in addition to various laboratory tests, which I call blood detective tests, to help figure out what people need. Let me give you two more benefits of juicing, potential benefits. One is it reduces inflammation. I've mentioned that a couple of times. It's really important that you know this, but the juices need to be, or the types of fruits and vegetables you use in your juices, need to be ones that you're not sensitive to and ones you're digesting and not promoting inflammation. So juicing typically, however, in a general sense, is rich in anti-inflammatory compounds, which can help reduce inflammation and alleviate a variety of inflammatory symptoms. And I think, as most of you know listening to the show, inflammation is fundamental for all human diseases. Juicing could be so powerful, it can help inflammatory conditions such as arthritis and gout, which is a different sort of arthritis that has to do with the accumulation of uric acid in the body. And the final benefit I'll talk about right now is how juicing can promote healthy hair and nails. So juicing is rich in vitamins and minerals, essential for hair and nail growth, including biotin, vitamin C, and silica, just to name a few. So what are 10 reasons why juicing might not be good for you? Before I tell you, just for, again, those just joining us, my contact information for questions, concerns, and show topics. My email is info@blooddetective.com. You can call me at 914-552-1442. You're listening to Ask the Blood Detective. I'm Dr. Michael Wald, and I'm located in Westchester County, New York. Okay, 10 reasons why juicing is not good for some people. Well, depending on the type of juicing you may do, it may lack fiber. So certain types of juicing removes the fiber from the fruits and vegetables, which can lead to digestive issues and constipation and blood sugar regulation problems and a lot of digestive stress and other metabolic issues as well. And then another negative of juicing could be nutrient imbalances. Juicing can cause an imbalance of nutrients in the body, leading to deficiencies of various vitamins and minerals. And you need vitamins and minerals as what are called cofactors, like a partner to work with enzymes in the body, which run every system. And then there's the high sugar content of some types of juices. So many fruits and vegetables contain high amounts of sugar. So you'll find them on that sheet I told you about, the glycemic index sheet, which these high sugars can cause a spike in blood sugar levels, which can lead to weight gain and eventually insulin resistance, which can cause high blood sugar, high blood pressure, and high blood cholesterol. Those three things are known as metabolic syndrome or syndrome X, very deadly problem. And then juicing is limited in protein. Juicing simply does not provide complete proteins, which are essential for muscle growth and repair. Now, some of you are thinking, well, I can just add my protein powder or have my protein in your diet. Yes, that might do it. But for example, if you add just pea protein into your juicing, that's an incomplete protein. You might want to combine it with rice because pea and rice is a more complete protein. And in other individuals, whey protein may be a better choice of proteins to help balance out blood sugar levels. But you have to know you're actually doing this, which is why the blood tests or the urine tests for blood sugar are important. The fifth reason why juicing may not be good for you is the potential for bacterial and fungal growth in the body. Juicing can create an environment in the body where bacteria can grow, leading to foodborne illnesses. This is documented stuff. The sixth reason that juicing may be bad is it can be expensive. Juicing is frequently expensive, especially if you're purchasing pre-made juices or invest in a juicer. But overall, of course, if you do it right, the cost, I believe, will outweigh any other consideration because you'll be healthier. Juicing is time consuming. Juicing can take quite a lot of time and effort, and you'll need to prepare and clean the ingredients and the juicer itself. And the juice that you make has a limited shelf life, and it can spoil very quickly, leading to a lot of waste. Number nine, some claim that a negative is that there's no scientific evidence to support the claim that juicing is a healthy or effective way, for example, to lose weight or improve health. This is a ridiculous concept, I'll admit it, but I wanted to mention it here because you might have heard this. I can only tell you that it depends on your particular needs and how your biochemistry responds to juicing, and it will respond in favorable ways and it will respond in non-favorable ways depending on many, many different factors. So just something to keep in mind. Juicing is not all good, and it's certainly not all bad. And some have reported that risk of contamination is a negative for juicing because juicing can be contaminated with harmful bacteria such as E. coli and Salmonella. And if the ingredients are not properly washed and sanitized, you increase the risk of any of these conditions. And also fruit, for example, and also vegetables, but mostly fruit, for example, like berries, strawberries, they may be infected with fungal mold. And you're consuming that mold. If you have healthy digestive capacity, your body will usually denature that mold and it won't be an issue. But many people, particularly individuals over age 50, 60% of people over age 50 do not make proper stomach acid. They have low stomach acid. That's called hypoglycemia. And they don't make enough pancreatic enzymes. So that's called pancreatic enzyme deficiencies. So when you eat these microorganisms, they get into the body. And this is what causes food poisoning or subtle health problems that are not recognized as food poisoning. It may look like memory issues, sleepiness, headaches, joint pains. All kinds of symptoms can masquerade from various microorganisms on fruit and vegetables. Now, having talked about these 10 benefits of juicing and 10 potentially negatives, let me get a little more specific and talk about the potential health benefits of juicing fruits and vegetables for specific health conditions. But keep in mind that, for example, the first health condition I'm going to talk about is diabetes. But many people are worsened by juicing, and many people are helped. So again, it's up to you and your healthcare provider through laboratory tests, questionnaires, the right medical intake, a nutritional visual exam, for example, to figure out what's right or wrong. And then there may be a trial and error period to see how you manage things. And by the way, just because you might have an adverse reaction, let's say a hypoglycemia from, let's say, drinking your juice, you might be able to adjust your diet and or use nutritional supplements to correct that problem. For example, if you want to help fix the hypoglycemia or hyperglycemia that might be caused by juicing, you might have, as I said earlier, added protein. And you want to make sure that that added protein is actually working by looking at the lab test. You can't just go by how you feel. Okay, so diabetes. So there are scientific studies that clearly suggest that consuming juice made from certain fruits and vegetables, such as cucumbers, carrots, leafy greens, they can help lower blood sugar levels and improve insulin sensitivity. And that was from an article in the American Diabetes Association called Juicing for Diabetes. And by the way, on their website, under the blog section for each of the podcasts starting in 2023, you will find the medical references for the statements I'm making here. Okay, the next condition that probably will benefit is heart disease. And there's many heart diseases, but I'm talking about this in a general sense. The fiber, vitamins, and minerals found in fruits and vegetables may lower cholesterol levels and reduce the risk of heart disease. They also might produce what's called nitric oxide, which is something made from blood vessels to open them up. Also, Juicing can help improve the flexibility of arteries because as arteries get hard, that increases risk of early death and disability. So the American Heart Association made that particular statement in an article known as, I believe it was Juicing for Heart Health. What about autoimmune diseases? I see lots of autoimmune disease in my practice, and some research suggests that consuming juice made from certain fruits and vegetables, such as pomegranates, turmeric, can help reduce inflammation and alleviate many of the symptoms of autoimmune disease like rheumatoid arthritis and others. And that was from the Arthritis Foundation in their article called Juicing for Autoimmune Disease. And what about overweight? Drinking fruit and vegetable juices as part of a healthy diet and exercise program can help with weight loss and improve body composition. Body composition is a test that measures your percentage of muscle, water, and fat in the body, and also the amount of water in and out of your cells, and measures a cancer marker called phase angle. And we know that when juicing is done correctly for someone who's overweight, it helps the body gain lean mass. Look, as you grow older, you atrophy, you shrink. So that means your muscles shrink and they get weaker, and your organs shrink, and your organs make your blood work. So as you lose the lean mass of organs and muscle, your lab work generally becomes worse. And that means you have less lean mass. And if that happens, you'll gain fat because it's the lean mass in your body, which is muscle and organs, which are the only things in the body, the lean mass, that produces the metabolic rate and burns calories. Fat and water in the body do not burn calories. And then there's hair loss. So the vitamins and minerals found in fruits and vegetables, like biotin and iron, they may promote hair growth and reduce the risk of hair loss. And that was from, you'll find that on WebMD in an article called Juicing for Hair Loss, but I'm going to tell you something and save you some time. For those of you who have tried biotin, very few of you will that work with. Hair loss and health problems are far too complicated to respond to one little thing. So if you've tried biotin and it hasn't worked, don't worry about it. It just means that you haven't looked carefully enough. If hair loss has to do with nutritional problems and the various health problems that I'm mentioning here, if you correct these problems, hair loss will usually correct, but not always. And then there's low metabolism. Consuming juice made from fruits and vegetables high in fiber and antioxidants may boost metabolism and improve health. So again, that was from, I think that article was called Juicing for Metabolism, and the source was Healthline. And what about arthritis? This is very common. So the anti-inflammatory properties of certain fruits and vegetables in certain individuals, and again, some of the foods would be ginger and berries, may help reduce joint pain and inflammation associated with arthritis. And that was from the Arthritis Foundation themselves in their article called Juicing for Arthritis. Some of you are thinking that nightshade plants make arthritis worse. Well, there's many types of arthritis, and nightshades do not affect everyone negatively. So I just wanted to throw that out there. And what about cancer? There's a good deal of research that suggests that if you consume juice made from vegetables and fruits that are very high in phytonutrients and antioxidants, such as berries, leafy greens, may help reduce the risk of certain types of cancer. And that was right from the American Cancer Society in an article that they produced called Juicing for Cancer Prevention. What about anxiety? So the nutrients in some juices, such as vitamin C, omega-3 fatty acids, they can help reduce the symptoms of anxiety and improve overall mental health. You'll find that article in Healthline called Juicing for Anxiety. And the last one I'll mention today is depression. So consuming berries, leafy greens can help reduce symptoms of depression and improve overall sense of well-being. And that was from Harvard Health Publishing in their article called Juicing for Depression. Okay, so here's the million-dollar question. How do you choose the right fruits and vegetables to use for your juicing efforts? Well, first of all, Fruit and vegetable juicing is a process of extracting the liquid from fruits and vegetables to consume as a beverage. Now, some health professionals recommend juicing as a way to increase the intake of essential nutrients and vitamins and minerals, because you wouldn't be able to eat the physical foods to get that. So juicing can break up the plant cell walls and release a lot of nutrients. So now that we understand the basics of juicing, what are some of the ways in which practitioners like myself, using my blood detective method, figure out what a person needs? So look, you've all had blood tests done, and there are normal ranges for your cholesterol and a normal range for your glucose and a normal range for your sodium and a normal range for your white blood cells, etc., etc. So these normal ranges, by the way, folks, they're based on average people. The average person is not so healthy. So why would you want to base your health on average clinical ranges, they call them, on the blood test? Well, that has some value, but there are what are called optimal ranges, which I have invented and investigated over the last 33 years, where I have found that there are ideal places within that normal blood range that might be better than being in another place. And each of these lab tests that I mentioned just before, cholesterol, for example, glucose, but every single other blood test that you can think of, almost every one has a nutritional association or many nutritional associations with it. So I'll give you a simple example. Cholesterol. If someone has a high cholesterol, they probably, the nutritional association should be lowering saturated fat, not eating fried foods, eliminating trans fatty acids, eating foods higher in niacin and red rice yeast, et cetera, et cetera. So those are nutritional associations for a test. So each of these lab tests have these nutritional associations. And then each lab test has a more ideally placed value. So for example, cholesterol. Most labs consider cholesterol between 100 and 200 as the normal range. So if you're anywhere within that range, your doctor will tell you you're good. But we know for scientifically that the higher your cholesterol within that range, the higher your risk of dying of heart attacks and strokes. So a 199 cholesterol is not as healthy as a 165. And by the way, folks, a cholesterol less than 160 increases the risk of a variety of cancers and also diminishes hormone production, because cholesterol is the building chemical that pregnenolone is made of, progesterone is made from, testosterone is made from, DHEA for the adrenals, and also all the estrogens made from cholesterol. So if you have a low cholesterol, you're going to have problems with a bunch of hormones and a potentially increased risk of cancer. You'll almost never hear this. I wrote a 500-page textbook on the medical and nutritional interpretation of labs called the Anti-Aging Encyclopedia of Laboratory Tests. It's a technical book. But the reason I mention it to you is I take that information and I apply it to blood tests that patients bring in when they come see me, or I draw the labs myself and do various other tests if appropriate. And then I read the labs based on the clinical ranges that every doctor uses. And also I use these healthy ranges, which are, as I mentioned, just with the cholesterol example, there's a better place in every range that's more optimal. And these are proven. I'll give you one more example that's probably on your last blood test that you've done. The LDL cholesterol, which is considered a bad cholesterol. Your blood work will now say that if you're 130 or less of LDL, that you have a normal LDL. It'll also say if you're 100 or less, you have an optimal LDL, which is much, much better. And these normal and optimal ranges are true for every single blood test. And that is what I've been investigating for years. So the right blood tests and right urine tests, read medically and the blood detective healthy, optimal way, will helps me determine what fruits and vegetables and juicing combinations of foods you need for your health. I probably should mention something else, which is important. I see patients sometimes that they're basically living off juicing, or they're doing juicing too often and it's diminishing their appetite and they're not consuming other solid foods. So let me just review some of the problems with this. So again, there's several reasons why juicing is not recommended as a primary source of nutrition. Number one, Depending on the type of juicing, it will remove fiber. So juicing can remove fiber from fruits and vegetables, which is an important source of nutrients and can help regulate blood sugar levels, promote digestive health, reduce cancer risk, help detoxification and elimination. Many, many benefits of the fiber in the fruits and vegetables which are removed for in those individuals that do juicing and do juicing too much. And then I mentioned there's a risk of contamination. Juicing can be a breeding ground for bacteria and other harmful microorganisms if the fruits and vegetables are not properly washed and handled. This is a major health crisis. And if you look at my website at www.drmichaelwald.com and search the search bar for hydrogen peroxide and vegetable cleaning, that'll teach you at least one way of cleaning of fruits and vegetables, along with maybe a mild soap. And also there's just nutrient imbalances if you're overdoing the juicing. So juicing can lead to an imbalance of certain nutrients, such as too much sugar and not enough protein and not enough healthy fats. Now, some of you are saying, well, I put avocados in there, and other people have even put olive oil in their juicing, just a little bit of that, or flaxseed oil. Well, that does help, but it depends on what you need. So it's just not possible to get everything through juicing. And it's certainly not even possible for many of us to get all of our nutrition that we need from foods. You know, I'm commonly asked the question, people will say to me, Dr. Wald, so which is more important, foods or nutritional supplements? And quite honestly, folks, that's a poor question, because it doesn't have to be a dichotomy. It doesn't have to be one thing is healthier, or I should say more desirable than the other. Some individuals, I would say most individuals, suffer from nutritional deficiencies. There are governmental studies that show this too. Many individuals suffer more than 8 different nutritional deficiencies. Now, 8 may not sound like a lot, but if you suffer from those nutritional deficiencies, those nutritional deficiencies will adversely impact how you use many other nutrients, causing a cascade of nutritional problems. And as far as nutritional supplements are concerned, you know, let's say you wanted to, and we're going to talk about this during my detoxification show, but if you wanted to detoxify, let's say, heavy metals in your body or viruses, you would want to use N-acetylcysteine. And that's not something you're going to get in juicing at all. You might get, of course, spirulina or fiber, and these are very weak detoxifiers. They're not going to detoxify you of chronically elevated, serious levels of toxins, almost never. In fact, some fruits and vegetables contain tons of toxins themselves, even when they're grown on organic soil, because the plants uptake the toxins in the form, for example, of heavy metals from acid rain and all sorts of other things. So again, we might need to take a supplement of N-acetylcysteine, particularly if you're a vegetarian or macrobiotic and you don't want to eat meat, which is a major source of cysteine, so you take a capsule of it. And there are many, many examples of nutritional supplements that make up for nutritional levels that you might need with your various health conditions, or maybe your health promoting or maintenance efforts, that you simply will not get from eating or juicing. You know, I've said this a number of times in several of my Ask the Blood Detective podcasts. People will say, well, Dr. Wald, we are what we eat. But we're not. We are not what we eat. We are what we absorb from what we eat, and we end up being the consequences of what we don't activate from what we eat. So there's nutrient intake, there's nutrient absorption or malabsorption, and listen carefully, folks, then there's nutrient activation, which is done in the intestinal tract and the liver. So for example, if your body eats cysteine in meat, for example, and we want it to detoxify heavy metals or viruses, your body has to acetylate it. It has to attach an acetyl group to it, and that makes it something different which can work. So that's the activation. If you search on my website for nutrient activation, I did an entire podcast on this. So, in conclusion, if you're considering juicing, it's important to choose the right combination of fruits and vegetables to meet your specific needs. you might want to consider my blood detective method to help determine your specific nutritional needs. As I look at your labs, I compare you to healthy, average people, as well as the clinical ranges. Those are the regular ranges your doctor uses. I figure, why throw that out? I can look at that, and I can also compare you to healthy people. And I'll just warn you, when you compare your chemistry to healthy people, you're going to have more abnormalities. That's not something to be afraid of. You want that information so you can adjust your diet, adjust your juicing, adjust your supplements, adjust your lifestyle in whatever ways that you and your healthcare provider determine is best for you. So everyone, juice smart, juice consistently, juice for a purpose, and juice for your life. Please join me every Monday on this podcast, Ask the Blood Detective. And you can also find this podcast, as I mentioned earlier, on practically every podcast platform. My name is Dr. Michael Wald. Reach out to me at 914-552-1442. Send me your questions and comments to info@blooddetective.com. And visit my website for free content at drmichaelwald.com. Be well, and goodbye for now, everyone.
Don't go changing to try and please me. You never let me down before. Don't imagine you're too